Pokemon Red and Blue are notorious for their glitchy nature, with infamous glitches such as the Missingo Glitch, Glitch City, and Underflow glitches with levels being among some of the most popular. Today, however, we'll be looking at some of the more obscure glitches that exist in Pokemon Red and Blue that aren't as popular that you might not have even heard of. These glitches aren't as big or impactful on the game, which is probably why they aren't as popular as some other glitches, but they are still pretty cool and worth talking about and interesting to discuss, in my opinion. I'll leave links in the description down below to the sources I use to learn about these glitches, so check them out if you want to see some other cool glitches as well. This first glitch is one of the coolest glitches I've seen in a while for any Pokemon game, which lets you evolve Pokemon that require a stone to normally evolve without having to use the proper stone. Basically, the way it works is you have a Pokemon that can evolve through a stone in your party, in this case we'll be using a Staryu, and then you level it up by essentially switch training with a certain other Pokemon, in this case Onyx, for the Water Stone, and once Onyx knocks out the final Pokemon to give your Staryu enough XP to level up, the game will also evolve Staryu into a Starmie for whatever reason. This works with any of the Stone Evolution Pokemon, with Onyx replacing the Water Stone of course, Exeggutor replacing the Moonstone, Growlithe replacing the Thunderstone, Psyduck replacing the Leafstone, and strangely enough replacing the Firestone is Missingno, the famous glitch Pokemon of Generation 1. This next glitch is a rather minor glitch, but it's still surprising to see how it made it into the game and through the testing phases, since it's something you would expect to be one of the first things tested when playing through the game. The way this glitch works is if you're in Professor Oak's lab selecting your starter Pokemon, you just keep trying to leave instead of picking your starter Pokemon. Oak will tell you over and over again to stop and to turn around and pick your starter Pokemon, but if you keep doing it, eventually this happens. The characters just sort of disappear, and it's not like it took too many attempts for this to happen in the first place. I wasn't able to move after performing this glitch, but once I saved and reloaded my game, everything went back to normal once I picked my starter. This next glitch is a sound-related glitch, which happens when your Pokemon's HP bar gets too low, and the game starts letting off that beeping sound to warn you that you have low HP and your Pokemon is close to fainting. This might seem like a really minor glitch, but due to the beeping sound, it causes other sounds to not play properly for other attacks. This is commonly used in speedruns of Red and Blue, believe it or not, since it makes some attacks slightly faster due to the sound being in the way from the low HP. I think it's pretty interesting to see how such a minor glitch could have such a big impact on a certain part of the game, making speedruns a little bit more efficient and a little bit faster. The Safari Zone in Red and Blue is rather infamous for many different glitches throughout the game, from the infamous Glitch City glitches to walk-through wall glitches even. This time we'll be using the Safari Zone for something a little bit sillier than those two. To start off, what you want to do is enter the Safari Zone as you normally would, and once you get through the gates that enter the actual Safari Zone, immediately turn back into the building, where the guide will ask you if you are done already. Tell them no, and you'll be turned back into the actual Safari Zone. From here, you want to save your game, and then reset your game. When your game loads up again, you're going to want to walk back through the gates again to enter the Safari Zone building, except this time the guide will be confused and think you are entering the Safari Zone for the very first time, although technically you are still in the Safari Zone as your step counter for the game is still going on, it's just invisible and you can't see it properly. When they ask you want to enter the Safari Zone, this time you tell them no, and they will force you to walk towards Fuchsia City. Once you enter Fuchsia City, you're going to want to fly to Viridian City, enter the gym in that city, and keep walking on these spinny tiles, which count as steps while you're spinning, and if the PA announcement for Safari Zone ending goes off while you are in the middle of spinning off of one of these tiles, your character will be perpetually spinning even when you're in the Safari Zone. Your character still even spins while on a bike, interestingly enough, so you can do some really cool 360 jumps off ledges with your bike. The strange thing about this glitch though was that for some reason I wasn't able to get it to stop. It is known as the perpetual spinning glitch, and I guess perpetual does mean forever, but I assume that restarting the game would fix it as I haven't seen anything otherwise that would say that this would last forever. Turns out I couldn't get it to end for whatever reason and my characters kept spinning, which is why you might see a spinning character through some of the rest of the clips in this video, because I couldn't get him to stop. This next glitch is in Misty's Gym, although it could be done in a few other areas of the game as well that have water. This is just one of the easiest places that this glitch could actually be done, and it's the place that I did it as well. All you have to do is surf in the water of the gym like you normally would anywhere else, and face this NPC so they're on the right of your screen. This glitch only works if the trainers are on your right, since you have to press the start button again, which will block the trainer, and then go to your surf Pokemon and click on surf in order to stop surfing. The game will think that you can step on the tile the NPC has stepped on, Instead though, since the NPC is there, you'll just get off in the middle of the water on top of where your surfing Pokemon was. This works if you do it on Misty herself as well, since she is on the right of your screen, although unfortunately you can't actually walk on the water, you can only stand in place, and the only areas you're able to walk are areas that have actual land, like the tiles around you. This next glitch is a rather minor visual glitch, but it's still pretty cool and pretty weird to see. All you have to do is get onto Cycling Road and head to the top left corner of Cycling Road near the Celadon City side. You'll notice that out of bounds you'll see some boulders lined up on the left, and all you have to do is go down on the left until you see water on your left instead of the boulders. When you head back up, you'll notice that some of the boulders are replaced by water in some areas, although this does change every time you go up and down. Unfortunately, this area of the game is inaccessible without doing any other glitches or hacks, but I think it would be pretty cool to see something like this with a change in terrain in an area of the game that was actually accessible, and if it would block you or not, or if you would just be able to walk right on top of it. This next glitch is really minor, but it's kind of funny and takes a little bit to set up. There might be some other spots throughout the game you can do this, I'm sure of, but basically if you force this NPC in Viridian City to go in certain directions by blocking off their path from moving in one direction, they will eventually walk into the door for the Pokemon Center, which of course would also work for the Pokemon Mart, but they won't actually enter it. This is just kind of funny to see because he's kind of just floating in front of the building. You could also force this same NPC to walk down the ledge in Viridian City, where you can then jump off of the ledge and land right on top of their head. I had no idea you could manipulate NPC movement like this in Red and Blue, which means that you could technically force this NPC even farther if you really wanted to, and I'm sure this will also work for other NPCs in the game. This just seemed like the easiest one to get to the ledge since he was already standing pretty close to it. This next glitch can be performed in any gym that has the gym statues in front of it, which is, well, all of them. We all know that you can already surf in Misty's Water Gym thanks to the pool that's located within it, but did you know you could also surf, and fish for that matter, in every single gym in the game, not just Misty's gym? All you have to do is walk up to one of these statues in the front of the gym, which happens to appear in pretty much every single gym in every Pokemon game, then try to use surf or try to fish, and it will just let you do that onto the statue for whatever reason. Not exactly sure why this happens, but I really can't blame them for not checking for this when bug testing the game, since why would anybody ever try to surf or fish on this exact statue? Continuing on with the minor visual glitches in Red and Blue, and trust me, there's actually quite a lot of them, we have what is known as the Amazing Man glitch for whatever reason. This can be done in a few different areas of the game, with the most common and most famous part of the game this is done in Cinnabar Island, with the man who magically stands on top of Blaine's gym when you interact with the sign in front of the gym. A very similar glitch can be done back in the bike shop all the way in Cerulean City. If you enter the bike shop, step to your left immediately, then step up while pressing A on this right bike over here, you'll notice that the bike shop owner is now out of bounds on the left of your screen when you have the text from the bike up. He will go back to his normal spot once you close out of the text box, and for whatever reason this glitch only works if you go about the bike and talk to it in a specific way doing these specific steps. If you come to it just straight from the right, he will not move into the void for whatever reason. The final glitch that I want to discuss is one that I've actually known for a while, in fact is one of the few glitches in this video that I've known prior to making this. All you have to do is go to the hotel located in the Celadon City, which you might notice very closely resembles a regular old Pokemon Center you'd see throughout the game. If you go to the top right corner where a PC would normally be in a regular Pokemon Center and press the A button, you will notice that you are actually prompted with the regular PC storage messages and have a fully functional invisible PC within this hotel. I'm guessing this is here because this could have been the original location for the Pokemon Center before they converted it to its new location, and they just forgot to fully remove the PC, or when they were building this room for this building, they just copy and pasted over some elements from the Pokemon Center and didn't fully remove the functional PC, just the actual image of it, while the PC was in fact still there. And those are just some of the lesser known glitches in Pokemon Red and Blue in this video that I want to talk about. Let me know in the comments down below which of these glitches you've heard of before, as well as any other potential lesser known glitches in Red and Blue that I didn't cover in this video. Generation 1 Pokemon games are a glitchy mess, and it's no doubt, and I think it's part of what makes these games a lot of fun. My personal favorite glitch out of these has to be the Stone Evolution glitch, which was the first glitch that we covered, since a couple of them are actually pretty easy to pull off, and I can easily see how one of this could happen accidentally to somebody when playing through the game normally and not even trying to go for it. Glitches like these are what really add to the charm of Generation 1 Pokemon games, in my opinion, and are a big part of what makes these games so memorable for me all these years later.